guys are with us today. Welcome to St. Matthew's. I said the right church this morning, actually. St. Matthew United Methodist Church. And for those of us that are joining us online, we just want to tell you guys, we love you and welcome to you too as well. We've got a great service of lifting up praises and the word to Christ today in honor of his name. And so we are so excited all of you have joined us here and that you're with us online as well. At St. Matthew, we are a Christ-centered family of grace where all are wanted. We are committed to becoming who Christ says we are, growing, living, and sharing God's love one relationship at a time. And it's in that relationship with God and in that relationship with each other. Will you just come as we just bow silently and just prepare our hearts for worship together? May we do that.
Please join me in our opening prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just give you this morning, we give you this place. Just pray that you'll prepare all of our hearts that are here in the building and prepare all of those that are listening to us, whether it's right now or any time during the week, for this time of worship and praise. We just give you our words, we give you our pastor, we give you our time together. And pray that you will just pour down your blessings on St. Matthew United Methodist Church. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good to see you all this morning. Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Leave it all behind. Leave it all. Have what you need. You keep on searching. You've done all the work. And you keep on working. When you're running on empty and you can't find a remedy, just come to the well. And the empty inside, it just ain't gonna listen. world can try, oh, but it can never fail. Now that you're full of love beyond measure, the joy's gonna flow like a stream in the desert. And soon all the world will see living water that found in me, because you come to the well. Yeah, people come to the well.
Special thanks to Kayla for keeping up with the slides this morning. I put those in. Sorry. I hope we were all still able to enjoy the song. Thank you so much for being here, whether you're here in the sanctuary or you're joining us live, and hope you'll start your watch party if you do that, because we want to share what we have going on here this morning. It's a great place. We do have some announcements. Remember that you can, through Facebook, or email us, or call the church office, or call Lisa in the evening if you have any prayer requests. An email will be sent out about that. And we have some amazing prayer warriors in this church who will immediately pray for whatever requests you have. We also have prayer warriors who pray on Monday morning and on Thursday morning, just to make sure that everything is covered. We do have a wonderful YouTube channel, and so if you want to see this later, you can go to Facebook or the YouTube channel, and there's some music recorded and all kinds of really good things there if you want to just have a little bit of uplifting time sometime during the week. A few other announcements. We do have a fellowship this evening for the 20-somethings. We're going to be at a park, so it's completely socially distanced. We do have a Sunday school class that has offered to pay for banana splits for everybody, but we're going to play disc golf at McCullough Park, which is a great socially distanced kind of game. And I started to say Mr. Ryan, because that's what I say all the time in school. Matt is going to teach us how to throw, and there's putters and drivers and all this stuff. It's just very similar to ball golf, but free. And really fun. So you can put McCullough Park into your GPS on your phone. That's for our 20-somethings and a few more. But we have gathered together a group of people on the praise team and helping behind the scenes that are amazing young people. And even though we're in a really crazy time, we want to reach out to them and keep them together and keep them fellowshipping, because we really do value them. Other things going on this week. The tool shed for our men's Bible study is on tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, so hope you'll join that. And we have up there the information, winning the battles that matter most. And so all men are welcome to join that via Zoom. If you don't have the Zoom link, let us know through the church office or Facebook or whatever, and we'll make sure you get that Zoom link. On Wednesday, we have brown bags and Bibles, so that's a special worship and praise time, and also some great learning time for us to help us grow as Christians. We remember also that every Saturday night we show reality through Facebook, and it's an amazing time of worship too. We're supporting them and being a part of something that actually started and was part of Hope Community of Shalom. It's just a really neat fellowship that the guys and girls have managed to keep going through this time of COVID, so we really value that. Transformers is next Monday, so ladies, do the best you can to read some of your things and keep up with an amazing book we're doing by Priscilla Shire. And we've been working on, and we really love your prayer support in this, Alpha, which is we start out with what is the meaning of life? And it's just a really wonderful way as Christians to make sure we have the foundation of understanding for who God is for us. And it's a great way for us to, in a really non-threatening way, maybe invite people that we know aren't Christians or are curious, or maybe you've been hurt at some point. It's just a really wonderful thing. And we're starting that Zoom at 7 on August 18th. So that'll be every Tuesday night throughout the fall. And I've had an opportunity to watch some of the stuff with it, and it's really, really wonderful, good stuff. So I think anybody who becomes a part of it, it's going to be good. You're going to really like it. We talked to you a little bit that Noah and Kayla, of course, are getting married in October. And if you would like to support them, they are on The Knot, which is a wedding website, which is really kind of like the thing now. And we even put in there theknot.com/Noah and Kayla Latham. So there's a la-la in the middle of it, so don't miss that. But if you would like to be part, you can support their honeymoon fund, or they've got a few other things. They're so sweet. They weren't even going to register on anything. And I said, oh, no. People want to support you. We love you. And so finally, I think enough people said something and they registered. So we're loving it. They've picked some stuff on Amazon and all kinds of stuff. So good deal. We want to support and love on them. Of course, we're still supporting our first responders in Aspen Village Ministry and want to continue to pray for them. So please do that. And remember that we got an email this week about Wester. So there's a list on there. If you would like to buy Ziploc baggies or some other things that those children are going to need this year that maybe would be beyond what some of their families can afford, then Todd has set up a box over here on the east side of the building, and you can just drive up and drop it off. And we'll donate all those things. Wester is our local elementary, and we want to love on them and support them any way that we can. And remember that we have Showing Up on Facebook, and we have, if you would like to give and be a part of something at the church, but you don't want to send in a check, then we do have an Aplos online giving that you can support. Birthdays. Our sweet Dixie Ross, I was just thinking that she was here before she was born. I mean, her mother grew up here and was pregnant here, and we have known Dixie her whole life, and so she's got a birthday, August 13th. We've got two precious couples that, Travis and Sandy Copeland and Malin and Nell Colson, who have anniversaries, and I thought this is just a time and a reminder to us to pray for those precious people. We love our Dixie. We want to pray for her, and those couples mean a lot to us. And we know that Malin and Nell aren't here in town anymore, but we want to continue to pray for them. So just their anniversaries are sweet, but we want to pray for them and what's going on in their lives as well. And I think that Carol's going to lead us now in our hymn of praise.
Our hymn of praise this morning is number 402, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian.
Oh,
Affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Our hymn of inspiration this morning is number 405, Seek Ye First.
Have some prayer time together this morning, and if we're to start out with our private requests that we have to lift up to the Lord, and then we'll join together eventually in the Lord's Prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just praise your name, and we thank you for being an amazing God who cares for so many aspects of our lives and has helped us so much through this time of COVID and has helped our church to grow and grow inside and even and grow in so many ways during this time. And as the tech students come back, Lord, we just lift up the tech administrators and the professors and all of those that are part of the dorm activities, and we lift up those students and just pray that you will keep them safe and give them wisdom. And Lord, we lift up our educators and pray that you will help them, whether they are doing school in their classroom or online or whatever they are doing. We just pray that you'll give them the energy and ideas to handle the situations and to help those babies. And we lift up those families who are trying to do education and work. We just pray that you'll help them. Just give us all a lot of grace and mercy during this time, mercy for ourselves and love for those children, and pray that you would keep those children safe. We continue to lift up our doctors in our community and our first responders in this neighborhood right around you, Lord. We just pray that you would help us to know how to reach out and love on the people in our neighborhood, and just pray that they will be able to see through us that you are amazing and that we offer, that you have offered to us mercy, so we offer mercy and love to them. We just now pray the way you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pam. Thank you, praise team. Thank you, Carol. I love that song, Seek Ye First. It reminds me of church camp. Y'all remember that high part that people sing, the Alleluia? I was trying to sing that over here, so I didn't do very good on that. So, but man, I always remember that. Boy, it just filled the tabernacle there at a one-way camp up in Happy, Texas, man. I just always remember that. It was so beautiful. So, guys, we're just really, really thank you so much for the way that you've been giving. And it really, really helps. It helps our ministry. You're giving through the church God's love and providence and His provision. We are, you know, helping lots of people, and also you're keeping the doors on and the lights on here, you know. And so I know that this is an odd, strange time for us, but our ministry is going. I don't know if you've realized, but we've started several new programs, which, by the way, those are yet just excuses for building relationships with other people, you know. And so that's just one other reason or one other connection or one other opportunity for us to fall in love with each other. And so I just want to encourage you to keep giving, and thank you guys so much for that. We did, I don't know if y'all caught it, but in the offertory time, you know, we're not passing plates around. We've got baskets set up here in the sanctuary. If you want to drop a check in, you know, or cash or whatever in there, and the ushers will pick those up later. But we're not passing the plate. We're not really passing out anything here. But what we did do was we went through our own gift offering as well of the fruits of the Spirit. Y'all remember that a few weeks ago, and we did every fruit of the Spirit. And so we're going to do another theme in giving like that, you know, because listen, it's just not about the money, right? You know, I mean, we give of ourselves the way that people gave in our lives that made an impact for Christ for us. And so because of that, we have instilled in us this blessing, this gift that wasn't meant to be kept, but it's meant to be given. So, yeah, we're gonna pray blessings over the cash and the money that helps us do what we need to do, but we're also going to pray blessings and cash over the best gift ever given to us, and that's you. That's you. And God wants you to spend yourself out each and every day. And guess what? He's going to fill you back up. So let's just pray for that. Father, we just thank you so much, Lord, for every cent, every dime that comes in, whether it's given online, it's placed in that basket, it's mailed into the church, or we go and get it, God. Lord, we just want to translate, God. We want to turn every penny into relationships for you. God, thank you for our neighborhood, Lord. I love this neighborhood. The laundromat and the Dollar General and, I'm sorry, Family Dollar over there, and then the, you know, the apartments and the, you know, the housing community behind us and our elementary. I mean, all of it, God, is just such a blessing to us to be right in the middle, in the midst of life here at Wester. And so, Lord, as we think about that, and we think about how what we give translates into loving relationships here, Lord, also remind us that you have given us gifts, God. And so we pray blessings over those gifts that you have given us, Lord. And may we share those gifts, God. Whether it would be in our living rooms, or whether it be, you know, on a Zoom call, or like the ninth Zoom call of the day, or whether it be in a classroom, or whether it be in an online classroom, God. Whether it be, you know, at the grocery store, or whether it be, you know, for a grocery pickup, or for a DoorDash delivery guy, God, you know, let them know that we love God by our love for them, God. So, Lord, we just pray that blessing. We pray, Lord, that we give that gift, the gift of you, away each and every day, Lord. So, Father, bless the money, but God, bless the people too, Lord. It's in your name we pray. And everybody said, amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is out of James, and it's James 1:12, and I'm reading out of the NIV this morning. Blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because, having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him.
Amen. Well, for me, this has been an interesting time with, the social distancing and all of the shutdowns and reopens and church with regathering. And one of the things that's really affected me has been sports. I don't know if there are any other sports people out there, but man, I'm a big sports guy. And I just have to tell you, the last few months, there really haven't been many games on, Now, I know that Major League Baseball and the NBA and the PGA is going again, but man, before that, to get my sports fix, I really had to go surf the internet for competitive games, that most of you would probably consider less popular than what you're usually viewing on TV. There are games like the Redneck Games. Have y'all ever heard of those? These are completely awesome. They include events such as the mud pit, belly flop, watermelon seed spinning, and lawnmower racing. And I know we have a slide for lawnmower racing. And I just wanted to that look awesome. That looks awesome right there, and stuff. You could tell he really put a lot of time into his lawnmower, right? That looks like a lot of fun. Have y'all ever watched chess boxing? Okay, it's exactly what you would think it would be. Players compete in 11 alternating rounds of chess and boxing, okay? There are 6 4-minute rounds of chess, and then there are 5 3-minute rounds of boxing. You got to go check this out. The first player to knock out or checkmate their opponent wins the game, okay? I just think that's awesome, man. And then there's the classic strongman competition. I know probably y'all have seen that before on TV, where the world's strongest men compete by doing things that are not practical at all, like pulling an airplane with their teeth or picking up really heavy things and then just setting them back down where they picked them up, right, Well, I think the truth is, for all of us is that we love challenges at some level, whether it be working the New York Times crossword puzzle or climbing a water tower if you're in La Mesa, Texas, right? Or getting past the Hammer Brothers level in Super Mario. Some of y'all can remember that back in the day, right? We often run to difficult challenges, but guys, here's the odd thing about that. As much as we love challenges, guess what? We also don't love challenges either. Though there are some hard things we definitely will run towards, there are also just as many, if not more hard things that we will run from. And running from difficult things is what I'm going to talk about today. We're in this series called I'm Not Going Back, and I've loved this series, and we're talking about some things that maybe we're seeing now that we just don't want to return to. And this morning, what we're going to talk about is we're going to talk about running from dealing with it. Now, when it comes to what challenges we face or what challenges we run from, I really think that it depends on the challenge and how that challenge might impact us. For instance, maybe we like running towards hard situations until they get personal or they get relational, or we discover that they're uncovering something within us that needs to change or that is difficult to change. If it's personal or if it's relational or something within us that's difficult for us to change, then we tend to run away from those things. We withdraw. We go AWOL. We get real passive really quick. Now, you've heard before this next phrase that in difficult situations, people often have a fight or flight response, right? They either run towards or they run away. Well, let me introduce you to Delilah. Look at Delilah. Isn't she awesome? meet Delilah. Now, the first thing that you need to know about Delilah is not how stinking cute she is or how mesmerizing or beautiful or faultless or precious or how much of a perfect princess she absolutely is, right? The most important thing that you need to know about her is that she is a runner, okay? All right. So she's a stone cold runner, and she is actually super fast. And if you set her down in the front yard, you'll be a runner too, right? You'll be chasing her for three blocks with a blown out flip-flop, yelling things you never imagined would come out of your mouth as you run through the front lawn of the Baptist church, by the way, chasing an 8-pound rocket of fur on wheels, okay? She's so very precious, right? You know, but I digress, you know. This morning, we're going to look at a story of another runner that's found in Genesis. And guys, I'm just going to just go from Genesis 24 all the way through 33, you know, in kind of summary. But we're going to look at the story of Jacob, all right? Now, look, Jacob was a runner too. This was his MO. He runs away from hard conversations. He runs away from hard conflict. He runs away from hard circumstances, and he runs away from hard consequences. And he isn't the only one who runs away from hard stuff like that either, is he? I mean, if we really are all honest today, most of us do or have run away from difficult things in our life. Now, one would think Jacob would be much stronger in dealing with hard things, right? I mean, he does have this deep, faith-rich family heritage. He was the grandson of Abraham, and he was the son of Isaac. And then Jacob also had this really man's man twin brother named Esau. Now, look, Esau was technically the oldest by a few seconds, so Esau naturally would receive the birthright. And the reason why I mentioned that is that's going to be very important as we get into the story. Now, even though they were twins, we read in Genesis chapter 25 that they were very, very different. The Bible says, as the boys grew up, Esau became a skillful hunter. He was an outdoorsman, but Jacob had a quiet temperament, preferring to stay at home. That's what Scripture says. So if Esau was an outdoorsman, then I guess that you could label Jacob as an indoorsman, right? And then this is where it starts to get personal and pretty complicated for the two brothers. Verse 28 of that same chapter in 25 says that Isaac loved Esau because he enjoyed eating the wild game Esau brought home. But then catch this, but Rebekah loved who? Jacob. So dad loved Esau, right? Mom loved Jacob. How we would say that in Lamisa in 1984 is Esau was a man's man and Jacob was a mama's boy. That's how we would say that, right? So Jacob probably didn't stand a chance against Esau in a wrestling match. Maybe if chess boxing existed back then, Jacob might stand a chance there, you know. But otherwise, anything physical against his brother, he just wasn't going to win at. But here's the deal about Jacob, guys. Jacob wasn't defenseless at all. He knew how to manipulate things to gain the advantage. In fact, Jacob's name literally means grabber or conniver or coercer or deceiver. Even when you think about how Jacob grew up, you know, as you read the story, you just kind of get the sense that, man, there's just going to be some stuff in this family, man, you know? I mean, he constantly hears the great story about God's blessing to his grandfather, Abraham, and then that blessing is passed down to his father, Isaac. And now that blessing, Abraham to Isaac, guess where it's going next? It's passed down to his older brother, Esau. Now, guys, I'm not excusing Jacob at all, but I sure can understand wishing to be somebody else. Can't you? I mean, I can understand thinking that others have it better. I can understand thinking how others got away with some stuff that when you did it, it severely cost you. So let me just say this. Though we can understand feeling that way, careful when thoughts wander around like that, because you're closer than you think to justifying actions you commit that you'd never put up with from someone else. And maybe that's a little bit of what's happened here. Maybe Jacob started this self-justification about what he deserved and why he deserved it. But whatever the reason, guys, Jacob decides he's going to find a way to cheat his older brother out of that blessing. That's all in Genesis chapter 27. So let me continue to summarize it. Essentially, here's what happened. Isaac, Jacob's dad, he's going blind. Jacob decides Isaac's blind enough that he can pass for Esau. And his dad won't catch him or know that it's even him. So Jacob even goes to great lengths to ensure this deception. He puts goat hair all over his arms, right? So that he just seems hairier as a guy, right? Bada boom, bada bing. He tricks his father, Isaac, into giving him Esau's blessing. Now, when Isaac realized what had happened, we see this in Genesis 27, verse 35. But Isaac said to Esau, "Your brother was here, and he tricked me. He has taken away your blessing." And Esau exclaimed, now get this, doesn't this sound like brothers? "No wonder his name is Jacob. And for now he has cheated me twice." Did you catch that phrase? No wonder? No wonder his name is Jacob. No wonder his name means cheater. No wonder his name means coercer. He's cheated me twice. He took my rights as the firstborn, and now Jacob has actually stolen his blessing. Now look, I don't mean to, you know, just to take this down a notch, but just to understand it on a smaller scale, this is like doing something really mean to your sister when she can't retaliate, right? Three things that you're going to know from that. First is that she's not going to let it go, all right? The second thing is that your life is now in danger, okay? And the third thing is that you don't know when she's going to get even with you, but you know it's absolutely coming, right? And Jacob knows this about Esau. Jacob knows that Esau is not going to let this go. And Jacob knows that Esau is going to threaten him. And Jacob knows that his life is now in danger. Jacob just doesn't know when it's coming. So here's what Jacob does. Now pay really close attention to this, because what he does next becomes this pattern in his life. He may not even realize it at the time, right? He may only think that he is fixing a particular moment, but instead what he is doing is he is creating in him a life habit. And look, guys, I just think this is just a great standard for us to be aware of and to remember. How you fix your moments is how you create your habits. Let me say that again. How you fix your moments is how you create your habits. So guess what Jacob does? He runs away, right? He runs away from it. Instead of dealing with the hard conflict, instead of having the hard conversation, instead of doing the hard thing and taking responsibility, he runs away. And he goes and he lives with his uncle Laban, right? Great uncle. Now, while he's at Uncle Laban's house, he falls in love with Laban's daughter, Rachel. So to have her, Jacob agrees to work 7 years to have Rachel's hand in marriage. Oh, but like the sands through the hourglass, how does that go? These are the days of our lives, right? So Laban gives Jacob a taste of his own medicine. And he tricks Jacob into marrying, catch this, the older, and the Bible points this out, this isn't me, less attractive daughter, Leah, all right? Now, guys, don't you just wonder how that happened? I mean, I always wondered, you know, how did Jacob get tricked into marrying the wrong girl, the wrong daughter? My guess is that it involved a combination of excessive alcohol and really bad lighting, okay? But that's not in the Bible, okay? Anyway, right, I go on. The Bible says that Jacob wakes up in the morning after his wedding. He rolls over in bed, and the Bible literally says this. In the morning, there was Leah. You know, I mean, it's just, you got to go read the story, man, all right? Anyway, Jacob agrees to work another 7 years if Laban would let him marry the younger daughter, Rachel. Look, guys, you can already tell, right? There's just a lot of dysfunction here. I mean, this is literally a sister wives situation, you know. It would have been an interesting reality TV show, these guys. And Jacob ends up working for Laban around 20 years, actually. And during that time, there's just lots of tension, and there's just lots of conflict, and there's just lots of stuff between him and his uncle. And we read that Laban cheats Jacob, and that he changes Jacob's wages 10 times. The scripture tells us that he's telling Jacob, you know, I'll pay you this much, you know, but he only pays him this much, you know. And in all of this, we never see this from Jacob. He never does the hard thing. Jacob never has the hard conversation. Jacob never sits down with his uncle and confronts him. But look, again, remember, Jacob's got skills. Jacob doesn't take it either. Instead, what Jacob does is that he does what he always does. Jacob slides right into that now so familiar pattern that he set many years ago. In fact, to Jacob, that pattern probably feels natural to him by now. That pattern probably feels comfortable to him by now. That pattern probably feels like the right thing to do to him by now. And Jacob begins to manipulate the situation, and he deals with Uncle Laban in Jacob's own very special passive-aggressive way. Okay, ladies, just give me a moment here. I just want to push pause here for a second, and I just want to talk specifically to our men, all right? Okay, guys, what we see here with Jacob is reflective of really two different ways. We as men tend to live out our masculinity if we haven't surrendered our testosterone to God, right? We become passive. Now, we see this in Adam. Now, guys, I'm in the camp that I believe Adam was present with Eve when she was tempted. You may not believe that. Doesn't matter if we do or don't. It doesn't say that. I just think he was there. But, and that just makes a lot of sense to me, you know. And by the way, guess what? Now, you know, the blame and responsibility can be shared, right, between, you know, Adam and Eve. And if you believe that way, then you have to look at it. Eve is being tempted by a serpent, and guess what Adam does? He just stands there, right? Something needs to be done, but he doesn't do anything. Something needs to be said, but he doesn't say anything. And look, guys, when we tend to be really passive when we don't know what to say and we don't know what to do. We tend to be passive because we really fear failure. And we sideline ourselves in our family, and we sideline ourselves at work or in our relationships because we get afraid. And because we get afraid, guys, we get passive. One more, guys. But I think this really applies to men and women both. So, girls, come back and join us, right? Yeah. But allow me to share this from a man's perspective, if you will. Another way that we tend to deal with our masculinity, guys, if it's not surrendered to Jesus, is we become aggressive. So look, God has given men this divine masculine energy. But when that energy isn't used for God's purposes, guys, then men tend to unplug or we tend to explode. Look at Samson. Samson, the strongest man in history, totally would have killed it in the strongman competition, right? He's a great example of this because he will go back and forth in his stories between silence and violence. Silence and violence. See, this is where masculinity gets really super, super toxic, guys. When a man uses his God-given strength to hurt rather than to help. When a man uses his God-given strength to demand rather than to serve. When a man uses his God-given strength to get what he wants rather than to sacrificially give of himself. Masculinity then becomes toxic. Look, biblically speaking, there's nothing less masculine than a man who takes advantage of the vulnerable or the oppressed or the defenseless. There's nothing biblical about a man who is rough with those who are fragile or dominating with those who are weak. There's nothing divinely masculine about a man who hurts the very people that he's been called to care for and to protect. So men, when our masculinity is not redeemed, when our testosterone is not surrendered to Christ, we tend to be passive, aggressive, passive, aggressive, passive, aggressive. And this is what we see with Jacob, guys. We see passive, aggressive people, they find ways to refuse responsibility. They might absolutely be killing it at work, but that same energy spent in their relationship just isn't happening. When they feel guilt and conviction about that divide, we see that passive-aggressive play the role of a victim. When they are challenged and confronted with that disparity, and they defend themselves by listing all the ways that they're unappreciated, we see that come out of them. When they are in this mindset, they don't want to be transparent with other people. You know, when we're being passive aggressive, we would rather devote energy to keeping up appearances rather than honest dealing with our problems. And passive aggressive people, they will manipulate situations by alternating wildly between hostility and contrition. To them, others' mistakes are unforgivable, but theirs are understandable. And instead of being direct with what they are feeling, they withhold things like affection or communication or encouragement or support. And you know, the big thing about passive-aggressive people that you'll find is they really hate to commit. They really hate to commit. They don't want to take a stand. You know why I can rattle that off so well? Because I have lived that life before. Does that sound familiar to you? And look, we just see a lot of this kind of gunk in Jacob's life. With Laban, he avoids the hard conversation and the confrontation. Instead, he manipulates and then he runs. Now remember, Jacob has this pattern in his life, and he's really become quite skilled at it too. Well, before Jacob leaves Laban, he manipulates the situation by getting his own livestock from the best of Laban's livestock. And then he runs. He secretly loads up his family and all of his possessions, and basically he sneaks away in the middle of the night. He never tells Laban that he's leaving, and by the time Laban finds out, Jacob and his crew have a 3-day head start. But in Genesis 31, it tells us that Laban and his men took off after him in hot pursuit. But God talks to Laban, and God tells Laban, look, don't harm Jacob. Don't harm Jacob. But Laban angrily confronts Jacob when he catches up with him. But guess what? Jacob doesn't fight back, right? Remember? But he says to Laban, and this is interesting, because he says this in kind of this rare moment of vulnerability. He says in Genesis 31:31, I rushed away because I was afraid. I thought you would take your daughters from me by force. He's saying, I ran away because I was scared. I ran from what was hard because I was afraid. And this is the cycle of Jacob's life. He tries to manipulate situations and coerce people until it catches up with him. And then once it catches up with him, to avoid the conflict and the confrontation or the consequences, he runs away. You know why? Because he's scared. Now look, maybe we can relate to this. Maybe some of you see this in you, like I see it in me. Or maybe you see this in someone that you know. Manipulate to get your way. Control it until you can't. Stop engaging. Withdraw. Run away. Rinse and repeat. Manipulate to get your way. Control it until you can't. Stop engaging. Withdraw. Run away. That's the cycle. So Jacob and Laban settle their dispute by essentially creating this border, meaning Jacob can't cross back over onto Laban's land. Laban leaves and Jacob continues west, headed towards his homeland where he grew up. But guess what? Here's the other problem, right? Guess who's in the homeland? Esau. Jacob can't go back to where Laban is, but Esau is where Jacob is headed. Remember, Jacob hasn't seen Esau since he cheated Esau and took the birthright away from him and ran away. So Jacob sends some messengers with obviously some really good gifts, right? And this message to Esau in Genesis 32, 3 and 5. Jacob sent these messengers to his brother in Edom, the land of Seir. With this message, he says, "Hello from Jacob," right? "I have been living with Uncle Laban until recently, and now I own oxen, and I have donkeys, and I've got sheep and goats, and I got lots of servants, both men and women. And I have sent these messengers to inform you of my coming, hoping that you will be friendly to us." And if you put that into like the more vernacular of today's language, "Hey bro, I'm coming in peace." That's what it would say, you know. "I'm really coming in peace. I hope you really treat me peacefully because I'm coming in peace." But then the Bible tells us in Genesis 32 and verse 6, the messengers, they return with news that Esau was actually on his way to meet Jacob. And guess with what? An army of 400 men. So they tell Jacob, "We met your brother Esau, and guess what? He was already on his way, man. Oh, and by the way, he's bringing 400 other guys with him." And so Jacob, guess what? He's terrified at the news of that, right? And why is he terrified? Because, look, he has nowhere to go. At this point, he can't go back. Laban's back there, and he can't move ahead. Esau and 400 guys is up there. So Jacob does this. Good financial planning, by the way. He divides up his wives, his children, his servants, and his livestock, and all of his possessions into two groups. And he sends them in separate directions, all right? So he thought, his thought was, when if Esau attacks one group, the other group can get away, and maybe Jacob will, you know, catch up with them later. Financial planners would say that Jacob is diversifying right there to minimize his losses, right? So but stop here for a minute and think about Jacob's situation. This is a no-win. It really is a no-win. There's no button left to push to get out of this. There's nowhere left to run to avoid it. He is surrounded on all sides, guy, by what's hard to do. And then the Bible tells us Jacob is left by himself. Verse 24, it says, "This left Jacob all alone in the camp, and a man came and wrestled with him until the dawn began to break. When the man saw that he would not win the match, he touched Jacob's hip and wrenched it out of socket. Then the man said, 'Let me go, for the dawn is breaking.' But Jacob said, 'I will not let you go unless you bless me.' 'What's your name?' the man asked, and he replied, 'Jacob.' 'Your name will no longer be Jacob,' the man told him. 'From now on, you will be called Israel, because you have fought with God and with men and have won.' 'Please tell me your name,' Jacob said. 'Why do you want to know my name?' And the man replied." Then he blessed Jacob there. Jacob stops running from what's hard, and he wrestles with a messenger from God. He wrestles more or less with God. I want you to notice that when that finally happened for him is when he was desperate, but also, guess what? When he was all alone. He has been running from God for a long time, and now he just finds himself in a situation where there is nowhere left to run, and he's all alone. It's my guess that all alone had not happened for Jacob in a really, really long time. Just think about the craziness that we've already looked at that surrounded his life. You know, from what we've read earlier, you know, it's obvious that he's probably a workaholic. And that's not surprising if you think about his family system. He was a man so desperate for a blessing from his father that he was willing to do anything to get it. His dad favored Esau, right, who was a man's man. So Jacob was determined to prove himself. So he works and he works and he works. That's not an uncommon story today. A child desperate for a blessing from a mom or dad pours themselves into their jobs, trying to be successful. You know, that's what Jacob's about. That's what a lot of us are about today as well. Also, Jacob had two wives. That's a bunch of kids, right? All kinds of servants. By his design, guess what? Life was surrounded by noise. He's never by himself. Things were never quiet for Jacob. There was always something that he needed to do, or there was always someone that needed him. His life was nonstop, but now, guess what? He's by himself. And in the silence of the night, and my guess is for the first time in a long time, his attention is available to where he can work through some hard things with God. I really hope that this has happened for us. I hope that this has happened for some of you, or is happening for some of you during this really weird time. I hope that you've had some unexpected time where things have slowed down and gotten quiet and maybe uncomfortably still, and you've been able to wrestle with God. You've been able to work through some hard things that, if you were honest, you've been running from for a long, long time. You know, the Bible says that after wrestling with God, guess what Jacob got? He got blessed. He's given a new name. He's given a new identity. And here's what's interesting about Jacob. We see that before all this, before he wrestled with God, when he prayed, he would refer to God as the God of my father Abraham, or the God of my father Isaac. In other words, he never really spoke of God personally, but only through the faith of his father and grandfather. But on that dark and desperate night, he encountered God personally, and their God became his God. And his new name totally reflects that. Now, during this time in history, names are especially significant, guys, because it was more than just what people called you like today. Hey, Todd, you know. It was your identity. My guess is that Jacob never really liked his name, right? Because every time it was spoken, all that he heard was cheater or conniver or grabber or coercer. Every time someone called him by his name, who he was being revealed. But in 27 and 28 verses of that chapter, God says, what's your name? And Jacob says, Jacob. And then he says, it isn't anymore. It's Israel, one who has power with God, because you have been strong with God and you shall prevail with men. See, God says, I'm giving you a new name. God says, things are not going to go back to the way they were before. If you live in that new name, if you live in the new identity that I've given you. And so finally, Jacob gets the blessing he had longed for his entire life. He didn't get it from his father, did he? He didn't get it from his uncle. He didn't get it from his older brother. He received it straight from God. And look, guys, maybe for some of us today, maybe we didn't get it from our mother, or we didn't get it from our father or our brother or our sister. Maybe you didn't get it from a coach or a pastor or a teacher. But I'm telling you this, guys, and this is the truth. God wants to give you His blessing. Amen, church? God wants to give you His blessing when you surrender to Him, when you stop running, and He blesses you. Jacob stopped running from what was hard, and instead of running away, guys, he hung on to God. He hung on to God, and he refused to let go. And then 25 says that little touch on the hip, remember that? Says that the man touched Jacob's hip. That word translated in Hebrew meant really like a light tap, like a light tap on the shoulder, right? And that light tap wrenches his hip completely out of socket. That light tap likely meant that Jacob will walk with a limp and some pain for the rest of his life. Jacob wrestles with God. He comes out of the match both blessed, but guess what else? Broken. And the limp he's going to have to live with the rest of his life is also the limp that will serve as his personal reminder of God's blessing each and every day for the rest of his life. Look, guys, truth is, you can be broken and you can be blessed at the same time. In fact, generally, that's how it works. Sometimes I wonder what the story was that went along with Jacob's injury. You know what I'm talking about? You know how we like to attach stories to our injuries? You know, like, yeah, well, I got that scar, you know, or I broke my arm, you know, or whatever, right? I wonder what Jacob's story was. You know, I bet it's a story that he told a lot. Like, you know, when people notice Jacob limping, you know, and they come up and say, "Hey, Jacob, what happened, man?" And then Jacob says, "First of all, my name's Israel," right? Remember, yeah, first of all, it's Israel, right? "Let me tell you what happened. I got into a wrestling match with God, ... right? Not bad to his wives and his children. I bet they, oh, man, not that story again, right? Rolled their eyes and acted like they're, oh, here goes, you know, here goes Jacob telling about the, or Israel telling about the story with, you know. But then, I thought about that more, and I bet that they actually loved hearing it. You know why? Because that story is the story about how God changed Jacob's life. And I just want to tell you, church family, there is just something incredible about a story of someone who has run and run and run, and then one day they stopped running and they said, "I'm not running anymore." And they wrestled with God, and God changed them. Now that's a great story. That's a great story. So Jacob is reunited with his family and his servants, and eventually he has no other option but to come face to face with who? Esau. His older, stronger, warrior brother, right? Whom Jacob had cheated out of his inheritance. Jacob prepared this great, generous gift for him, you know, and was hoping that it'll appease Esau's anger. But then we see in Genesis 33, verse 3, Jacob went on ahead, and as he approached Esau, he bowed 7 times. Then Esau ran to meet him and embraced him affectionately and kissed him. And they were both were in tears. That's a beautiful story. That's a beautiful story, but in some ways, when I read that, that's kind of a sad story to me too. It's sad because I think maybe this just took so much longer than it really needed to. Several decades had passed, right? Yeah, they finally reconciled, but maybe it didn't have to take that long. Sure, maybe Esau wasn't ready before then to reconcile, but what if he was? What if maybe a month after that happened, Esau's heart already began to soften? What if maybe a year after Jacob cheated him, the bitterness had mostly disappeared? What if Jacob hadn't kept running from what's hard? Then maybe this blessing and this reconciliation would have happened much more quickly than it did. Maybe this family would have been brought back together and reunited 20 years earlier from when it happened. Look, guys, I just want to challenge you. Let's not wait another 5 or another 10 or another 20 years. Can today be the day where, you know, we surrender and stop running and we wrestle with God? Can today be the day where we won't let go of God no matter what difficulty or problem that we are facing? You know, the Bible tells us that Jesus brings this reconciliation to us, that Jesus came to make things right between us and God, but also to be the reconciler between us and one another. So in these next few minutes, I just want to think, us to think of this time as a time where we're going to just, it's okay, we're going to wrestle a little bit with God, where you're going to be honest about some things, right, that you've been running away from, and maybe some things that you need to start running towards, even if they're hard, even if they're difficult. And look, you don't have to run alone. I mean, guys, as a church family, we want to run with you. Amen? We want to run with you. And most importantly, guys, Jesus wants to be with you. You know, he gives you the strength and the grace that you need for that journey that lies before you in your life. So as the praise band comes back up, we're going to do, you know, one more. I love this song that they're going to do, you know. I just ask for us, right, when they sing this and as we kind of prayerfully meditate at home or here in our sanctuary, let's just let this be a time of surrender where we stop running. And let's just let this be a time of invitation where we ask Jesus that he help us be obedient to what he's called us to do. So will you do that with me? Let me just pray for us. God, Father, I thank you for your grace towards us, Lord. Thank you for the fact that when we come to you, and Lord, maybe for a lot of us, we have been running for a really, really long time. But that when we do come to you, God, we find that you have already taken tons of steps towards us, Lord. And you are there, not with a fist, but you are there with arms open wide because of Jesus. So, Father, let us experience that grace this morning, Lord. God, for those who are listening and they need a new name, they need a new name, God, I pray that they would listen to you to find their new name, God. They don't have to be who they have been before, Lord. They are new in you right now. No matter how long, God, they've been running, Father, you want them in your family. You want them in your family. And you will give them the grace and the strength to run to you through your Son, Jesus, and what he did for us on the cross, God. Lord, for a lot of us, it's just time to stop running. We want to face you. We love you. Thank you for loving us, God. It's in your name we pray, Lord. Amen.
We turn our eyes from evil. evil things. Oh Lord, we cast out our idols. So give us cleanness, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us cleanness, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face.
Absolutely loved having you with us. Guys that are here face to face, I just want to give this benediction for all of us. Pam's going to come up and give our online family some more information after I get done. But please accept this benediction right now. By the way, love you guys. Y'all are awesome. Love you guys. Y'all are awesome. Father God, we lift ourselves to you, Father. We do bow to you, God. Lord, no matter how many miles we have run, no matter how fast we have been, no matter how passive-aggressive or how much we have learned to manipulate the things around us, Lord, you, God, have a new name for us, Lord. You help us face every difficulty. Lord, we are tired of running from not dealing with it, God. You give us the power and the strength and the life, Lord, to live for you in this world, God. So thank you. Carry that blessing with you as you go. And all of God's people said, amen.
Thank you so much, our online audience, for joining us this morning. We really appreciate that you use your time with us this morning. You are a blessing to us. I do want to remind everybody that we are working towards supporting Wester Elementary. And so if you want to pick up something and donate it to them, you can do that until 3 o'clock this afternoon. Monday 9 to 1, Tuesday 9 to noon, Wednesday, Thursday 9 to 1, Saturday 10 to noon, and then also next Sunday 8 to 3. And if you will let Jeannie know, call the office or the pastor. You can just drop it off on the east side of the door, and then somebody will come out and get it and bring get all of that stuff together to take to Wester. Again, thank you for joining us. And just as a final word, remember our scripture that we chose as our church scripture, Jeremiah 29:11. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Blessings to you. Thank you.